maybe just by way of context setting as well, what is an investment product for anyone that is new to attending an ASX financial advisor webinar? We have over 600 what we call investment products that are listed on the ASX. There'll be some structures there that you're quite familiar with, such as exchange-traded products, or more commonly referred to as exchange-traded funds, listed investment companies and trusts, Australian real estate investment trusts, infrastructure funds, and also unlisted managed funds, or what we call our M Fund service, which I'll be talking about later during this presentation. But effectively, all these are pooled investment structures that enable investors to be able to access professional investment managers and really diversify their portfolio across various asset classes and also investment strategies. Importantly, all of these investment products can be held on an investor's holder identification number or the broker-sponsored HIN. This gives investors name on title. It allows them to hold all of these products and including their Australian shares all in one place. This gives investors transparency and also settlement certainty. And the whole process endeavours to make buying and selling of investment products more efficient and also cost-effective for that end investor. There's actually over 6 million Australians that hold on-exchange investments. So as we would all know, Australian shares are the most popular investments that are held by Australian investors. And what we are endeavouring to do is help those investors that probably already hold Australian shares use other products to diversify into things such as global equities and fixed income, but also into investment strategies, be they index tracking investment strategies or active investment strategies. And while we've had great uptake in the number of investment products used by retail investors and financial advisors, we still think that there's some work to be done to help those investors achieve diversification. One segment of the Australian investor landscape that does love using ASX listed products are self-managed super funds. As many of you will know, there's over 1 million self-managed super fund trustees in Australia, and they hold an incredible amount of assets in over $700 billion of assets sitting inside self-managed super funds. And of that $700 billion, there's over $250 billion that's actually sitting on the ASX. And as you've seen on the previous slide, it's predominantly in Australian shares and probably predominantly in Australian large cap shares. And again, what we're hoping to do is encourage self-managed super funds to achieve diversification using the investment products that we've talked about. What's going to be a really interesting trend, I think, over the next couple of years is how self-managed super funds do diversify away from some of those Australian equities or perhaps being overweight Australian equities, and also deploy the large amount of cash that is sitting in self-managed super funds at the moment. Three of the product structures that we tend to focus most of our time on are listed investment companies and trusts, exchange-traded products, and M funds. Listed investment companies and trusts are closed-ended vehicles, and that the market cap of those vehicles is currently sitting at around $55 billion. These are the oldest product structure that has been made available on the ASX. So trace their origins back to the 1920s. There's over 100 listed investment companies and trusts that are available on the ASX. And while there's been tremendous growth over the last 5 or 6 years in this particular segment, the last 12 months has been quite a difficult and challenging period for listed investment companies and trusts. We haven't seen any new IPOs in this market. COVID has played an impact in relation to their ability to raise capital, but also the banning of stamping fees last year by the government and the regulator. There are some optimism in this sector with some listed investment companies and trusts currently in the market raising capital. So it'll be interesting to see over the next year or two how this sector comes back to life. Exchange traded products I'm going to focus on a bit in this presentation, so I won't dwell on it too much on this particular slide, but suffice to say, there's over $100 billion sitting in exchange traded products at the moment and over 200 funds. There's actually been over a 70% increase in that funds under management year on year, so tremendous growth in this particular product segment. And as for M Fund, the newest product that's available on the ASX has been running for about 6 years now. We have reached $1.7 billion in funds under management, and that continues to go from strength to strength every year. There's now 240 funds on the service, and that's very quickly getting towards 250. Again, strong growth with over 50% growth year on year in M Fund. And I'll be touching on exactly what M Fund is later in this presentation. In terms of some of the recent trends that we've seen with these particular products, I suppose there's two narratives to talk about. One is around fee compression, and the other is about product differentiation. First of all, on the fee compression side, we've seen investors predominantly flock to those exchange-traded products that are offering low-cost exposure to market, so predominantly index-tracking funds. That's not going to be a surprise to many of you on this particular webinar or video today. But I think what's an interesting trend, and it's at the margin, but it'll be exciting to see how this plays out over the next couple of years, we've actually seen on a percentage basis a slight increase in the number of investors using active funds that are also exchange traded products. So we'll see how that plays out over the next couple of years. The other really interesting trend has been around product differentiation. So rather than bringing low cost product to the market, fund managers are now really starting to differentiate their products based on the categories that you can see down here. To illustrate that a little bit better, I've split out some trends here on the graph by those particular categories. In terms of asset classes, structures, listed investment trust structures such as MXT or Metrics Credit has enabled investors to be able to get access to private credit. Across geography lines, the Fidelity India Fund and also the Fidelity Emerging Markets Fund has enabled investors to diversify into high growth areas of the globe. By sector, you can almost play out any particular theme that you want as an investor. The ETF Securities Global Robotics Fund is a great example of that. What's been a great trend as well has been the emergence of smart beta products being launched on the ASX. This is a really deep part of the market in areas such as the US, and increasingly on Australia, we're starting to see smart beta products come to the ASX, and the Vanguard Global Minimum Volatility Active ETF is an example of that. It's also been great to see alternatives products coming to ASX across the Winton Global Alpha Funds, the Firetrail Absolute Return Fund, and also the Pengana Private Equity Fund. Investors can really start to implement alternative strategies inside their broader investment portfolio. So now just touching on exchange-traded products, I'll see how I'm going for time. Globally and locally, exchange-traded funds have been a theme for the last number of years. And in particular, 2020 was an extremely exciting year for exchange-traded products. You can see on the graph on your left, which tracks inflows into exchange-traded products, that 2020 eclipsed all other years with just under $20 billion of inflows into exchange-traded products. 2021 has started off really strongly as well, comparative to other years, but 2020 far and away was a real step change for exchange-traded products. It was really interesting as well to watch how exchange-traded products performed during the periods of market volatility that we saw last year. And you can see that chart on the right-hand side, which shows trade value in exchange-traded products during 2020 and that spike in March when we had markets decline and then also rapidly pick back up in the April period. And I think it's fair to say that exchange-traded products performed really well during that period of market volatility. Just touching on inflows for a little bit. So this particular chart shows the top 10 ETPs by fund flows for the last 12 months. It's not going to be a surprise to any of you to see the iShares and also Vanguard Australian ETFs featuring in spots number 1 and 2 there. I think some really interesting themes to pull out of this slide as well are around global equities. So it was interesting to see the BetaShares NASDAQ 100 fund featuring third spot there. And also the BetaShares Global Sustainability Leaders ETF featuring in the top 10. And we're going to be having a session about sustainability and ESG later on today. I think the other really interesting thing from my point of view is the Vanguard Diversified High Growth Index ETF featuring in the top 10. That fund allows investors through one transaction via their broker to get a very diversified portfolio. And then lastly, it's probably not a surprise, but to see the ETF Securities Physical Gold Fund also feature in the top 10 there. By traded value, there's some common themes coming through, but also some slight differences. So, of course, the Vanguard Australian Shares Index ETF featuring number one in terms of traded value. But some other interesting trends as well, the BetaShares Australian Strong Bear Fund, and also the BetaShares US Equities Strong Bear Fund featuring in the top 10 there, and I think really demonstrating how investors are trading market volatility over the last 12 months. Again, the ETF Securities Physical Gold Fund featuring in the top 10 of traded value there as well. These next two charts look at the average number of unit holders per product that are listed on the ASX for exchange-traded products. The chart on the left-hand side, you can see how the average number of unit holders in passive or index tracking ETPs has been growing month on month. And that is probably not going to be a trend that's surprising to any of you there. I think that really plays into investors using that core satellite approach that we're all very familiar with. An interesting trend, though, is on the right-hand side. When you look at the average number of individual unit holders now holding active fixed income strategies, actually overtook passive strategies in July, August of last year. Perhaps a representative of findings from the SPIVA report, S&P SPIVA report, that shows there's perhaps alpha to be found by active management inside the fixed income space. The last trend in relation to exchange traded products that I'd like to share with you is the adoption by next generation investors. Last year, ASX produced a research document that we do every 2 to 3 years called the ASX Australian Investor Study. And it's not going to be a surprise to any of you to see retirees featuring as the most common user of Australian shares held directly. But what is really exciting to see are next generation investors' adoption of ETFs. In fact, findings from the US through research conducted by brokers over there shows that an ETF is more likely to be the first investment made by a next generation investor than holding shares directly. And I expect we'll see that trend play out for years to come. I'd just like to finish off quickly by touching on MFund. There may be a number of you on the call that are not familiar with MFund. MFund is a service that was created by the ASX 6 or 7 years ago, and effectively it allows investors and their financial advisors to buy unlisted managed funds using ASX's infrastructure. So an investor can set up an account with their online broker, who is a participant of MFund, and because the broker has done their AML KYC checks, all of the identity sits with that broker. The investor then can quite simply place an order into an unlisted managed fund that is available on the MFund service. And as I mentioned earlier, we have 240 funds on that service. Once that order goes through, settlement occurs by the unit registry or the fund manager. And then those units that the investor has bought sit back on the investor's HIN. So again, the investor can see all of their investments alongside shares, exchange-traded funds, listed investment companies, and now also MFund. There are 19 brokers connected to MFund. And really what we're seeing is strong adoption, as I'll talk to in the following slides, in that middle channel by financial advisors who are very used to buying and selling in unlisted managed funds, but are perhaps looking for a way to do that rather than going directly to the fund manager where typically you're looking at complex application forms that need to be filled out. As I mentioned, high adoption by financial advisors. So in fact, over 70% of inflows is from financial advisors. And core to MFund is used by self-managed super funds. So it really plays into that theme I talked about before, whereby self-managed super funds are very used to holding assets on their HIN on the ASX, but they're probably overweight Australian equities. And they're really using MFund to get access to other asset classes and investment strategies. And in fact, research again from the ASX shows that high value investors are three times more likely to use MFund than a retail investor. In terms of what asset classes are they using via MFund, it's predominantly fixed income, and PIMCO is the leader in terms of funds under management by managers, but you can see the top managers there on the right-hand side for MFund. The other asset class that's used quite predominantly for MFund is access to global equities. So just a bit of a recap, listed investment companies and trusts have had a bit of a tough time of it over the last 12 months, but there's some optimism going forward with some products in the pipeline. Exchange-traded products can continue to go from strength to strength, and while we have seen a trend around fee compression, at the margin we're starting to see increasing use of active ETFs. And lastly, for MFund, now at $1.7 billion and 240 funds on the service, providing the ability for investors to achieve diversification. So bringing it all together, what are we trying to do here? The chart on the left-hand side really tries to demonstrate that. Investors can now own direct shares, listed investment companies, exchange-traded funds, and unlisted managed funds, all on their broker-sponsored HIN. We believe this is efficient to do, provides investors with choice now that there's over 600 investment products available. It hopefully makes the transacting in these products and also shares cost-effective for end investors. And because it's all held on the ASX, we hope that increases the level of transparency available to investors as well. So this is us. Please always feel free to reach out to the ASX team if you do have any questions about anything that we've talked about today. We've also got a monthly email that goes out that features these trends on a monthly basis. But with that, I'll hand back to Anastasia for our next session. Thank you.